One of the most prominent streets in Hollywood is Ivar Street, one of the closest to the 101 freeway. Let's take a look, shall we? Ivar Street was named after Ivar A. Weed, who was a prominent businessman, real estate developer, and neighbor of Data Wilcox. He later became involved and became friends with H.J. Whitley, Colonel Griffith of Griffith Observatory fame, with developing the Hollywood branch of the Pacific Electric Railway through Prospect Avenue and various parts of Los Angeles. Weed helped to promote Good Roads and Sunset Boulevard after he made a fortune on real estate. He died in 1903 during a visit to his homeland in Denmark. One of his daughters, Selma, got her name on a Hollywood street as well. One interesting apartment actually made an appearance in one of the most iconic films of all time, Sunset Boulevard. In the film, we see William Holden's character working on his script.
I was living in an apartment house above Franklin and Ivar. Things were tough at the moment. I hadn't worked in a studio for a long time. So I sat there grinding out original stories, two a week. Only I seem to have lost my touch. Maybe they weren't original enough. Maybe they were too original. All I know is they didn't sell.
It was built in 1930 and was first used as a hotel, but later changed to an apartment in the late 40s. Not only has this apartment served as a backdrop to many films, but has housed many celebrities including Fatty Arbuckle, George Cukor, and Claudette Colbert. Just down the street of the Altonito is another Hollywood gem and one of the most iconic hotels in Hollywood, which is the Knickerbocker Hotel. Upon its opening, it was one of the most glamorous hotels in Hollywood, hosting so many celebrity appearances including Marilyn Monroe and Elvis Presley. Yet this hotel had a lot of unique situations as well, including Betty Grable hosting Jackie Coogan's 21st birthday party, which included a young Lucia Ball dressing up and Johnny Weissmuller hammering up on a piano. Yet this former hotel also had a macabre side to it that continues to fascinate many. The famous magician and stunt artist Harry Houdini made a promise to his wife Bess that he will somehow communicate with her a special message from the other side. Since Houdini was interested in the afterlife, he wanted to prove that he can connect with Bess beyond the grave. She would hold seances on the roof of the Knickerbocker every year on Halloween, since that was the day he died. Unfortunately, to no avail.
Now let us bow our heads in meditation and prayer. O thou master mind of the universe, we have waited, Houdini, oh so long. Never have you been able to present the evidence you promised. And now, this is a night of nights. The world is listening. Harry, your world, your audience. And Bessie is here. Your Bessie, who was part of you for 33 years. She's here, Harry, pleading in her heart for a prearranged sign from you.
Mrs. Houdini, the zero hour has passed. The 10 years are up. Have you reached a decision?
Yes. Houdini did not come through. My last hope is gone. I do not believe that Houdini can come back to me or to anyone.
In 1962, a designer named Irene Gibbons committed suicide by jumping from her apartment window on the 11th floor and lay undiscovered for 3 days. According to her friend Doris Day, she had told her that Gary Cooper was the love of her life. Another tragedy was the death of William Frawley, famous for playing Fred Mertz on I Love Lucy.
Hey, listen, by the way, what do you know about rice? Well, I had it thrown at me on one of the darkest days of my life.
He was watching a movie on Hollywood Boulevard, where he was walking back to his hotel, and suddenly suffered a massive heart attack, right near the stairs to the entrance. A Birth of a Nation director, D.W. Griffith, also died under the chandelier in the lobby of the hotel after living the last years of his life in isolation. In 1943, an actress named Frances Farmer was arrested for missing payments of a drunk driving charge, and she was dragged out to the lobby, facing a barrage of photographers. The once glamorous hotel was going through some changes, especially with Hollywood becoming increasingly seedy and dangerous. The hotel went through many owners, and eventually became a retirement home. Notice how the sign says, The Knickerbocker, instead of Hotel Knickerbocker? The sign still appears to have the H and L, but they are just blacked out.
Our two subjects are in room 205 of the Hollywood Knickerbocker Hotel. That's just a short block from here, just behind our theater, as a matter of fact. And they're talking to a friend of theirs, one of England's most prominent producers, Mr. Bernard Delphont of London, whom we brought here to Hollywood just to make our surprise work. Now listen, we have a television camera hidden behind French doors in the kitchenette, you see, of the hotel suite over there. Now on my signal, the door will fly open. So the doors will go open, the lights will go on, the speaker will go on so they can hear, and well, you'll see what happens. Think. All right now. Everything ready, boy? Here we go. Take it away. Camera number 5 in the kitchenette of suite 205 at the Hollywood Knickerbocker Hotel. Here we go. Mr. Stan Laurel, Mr. Oliver Hardy. This is Ralph Edwards speaking to you from the El Capitan Theater on Vine Street here in Hollywood.
What do you think, Mal?
Yeah, sure. It's a good idea. I'll take care of it.
Good. Then we'll start with Mr. Geezy and go on from there.
Around the early 2000s, they decided to turn on the neon lights and make it reminiscent to how it looked like in its golden age. The night sky gives it a more eerie tone. Just around the corner of the Altonito is a Hollywood gem indeed. According to the LA Times article, A Walk into Movie Land History, there is a house on Dick Street, near the park, the article states, that the house was built around 1910 to 1915. Any spectator can just look at the house, and just imagine who must have dwelled in that house, who passed that house, and how much history the house has witnessed. I stumbled upon the house within my research, so I knew I just wanted to display it. Unfortunately, a lot of people when visiting Hollywood just want to see the touristy attractions. But if they took some time to check out the history, they'll discover that there is so much to learn. Every corner and building has a story, and it is my turn to show it. Join me in episode 4, where we explore the most iconic street in the world. Can you guess what it is?